The Federal Inland Revenue Service, FIRS, calls on all corporate organizations operating in Nigeria to register for the purpose of payment of taxes and obtain a tax identification number, TIN. All registered companies must obtain a tax identification number immediately from the nearest FIRS office. You can also collect and return tax registration forms from the Federal Inland Revenue Service Engagement and Enlightenment Tax Teams, FEET, on compliance checks exercised in your area. A company which is yet to commence business after at least 6 months of incorporation must pay a pre-operational levy of 20,000 Naira in the first year and 25,000 Naira for subsequent years to obtain its tax clearance certificate, TCC. Note that filing and payment of VAT and withholding tax returns must be done on or before the 21st day of every month. Register for VAT. File all tax returns as and at when due. Be a responsible corporate citizen of Nigeria. It pays to pay your tax. This message is from the Federal Inland Revenue Service.
I want to be a doctor and help people when they are sick.
I want better education and training so I can be a soldier and protect my country.
I want better roads to avoid accidents so I can get to school on time safely.
What crazy? Or talk crazy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, trading looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Excuse me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to the secret. I said, oh, hell
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
Hello, you're welcome back to Core Digest, our steamy breakfast participatory program on Core TV News Lagos. And my guests are still here. If you're just joining us, our topic is Constitution Amendment, the unending bazaar. Why did I call it an unending bazaar? It's because close to 20 billion naira has been expended since 1999 to date. Let me just quickly reel out to you how these monies were withdrawn even in the 7th Assembly, the 7th National Assembly that ended last year. Take for example, in our investigation lasting several months, we found out that between 2011 and 2015, the 53-member House of Representatives had a Constitution Review Committee and its 49-member counterpart in the Senate in the 7th National Assembly withdrew 3.2 billion naira and 4.5 billion naira respectively to purportedly execute the fourth alteration of the Constitution. It is not immediately, however, clear, you know, how the lawmakers spent the outrageous funds, but insiders, of course, information is that a chunk of it was pocketed by members of the committees in what one source described as unprecedented Naira Bazaar by Committee of the National Assembly. Officials of the committees continued to make withdrawals even long after the exercise was concluded. It remains unclear what those withdrawals were for. Take, for example, some of the curious withdrawals will find that the House Committee withdrew 500 million of public funds on December 16, 2011, 500 million on May 17, 2012, 250 million on October 29, 2012,
250 million on May 8, 2013, another 250 million on August 6, 2013, and 250 million November 11, 2013. It goes on and on and on and on like that. In fact, for the Senate, it even operated, the Senate Ad Hoc Committee operated two accounts, one named account A and account B. You know, even, oh, this is, gentlemen, let me not say the process of, let's begin first.
Why are you passing the edict to us?
No, let me begin first. The process of constitution amendment is germane in any democratic dispensation, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
To the extent that there are sufficient force in the constitution, because you just don't embark on the voyage that has no cause. There must be a reason for you to want to amend the constitution. That's what I'm saying. To the extent that you are able to identify certain things that are wrong with the constitution to that extent, I'm just trying to elucidate. I'm just trying to explain what your proposition is like. You know, like the members of the School of Logical Positivism will tell you that the meaning of a proposition depends on its method of verification. So if you are saying that X amount of money is going to be expended on a particular project, we want to know what are the projects on ground for the money to be expended on. If we are saying that, you know, it's necessary from time to time for us to amend constitution, the question is that, you know, why do we have to do that from time to time? You know, was it that we're not able to get it right from the very beginning? Was it that we're going to try and error? Was it a case of somebody, a charlatan being given a professional job to do, and then he finds out that what he has been able to put together is not effective? You know, I think we have to do some forensic study of that thing for us to say that, okay, it's necessary for us to continue to amend from time to time.
The profanity that was always, you know, exuded or elucidated about the 1999 constitution as amended had always been that it was foisted on us by the military.
Well, it is no more a new statement, is a truism. And my problem is about the fact of the matter. If something is built on lies, we'll continue to get one thing or the other. I mean, just like naturally, you tell a lie, then you want to look for another lie to cover it up. And that's the problem of Nigeria. And I belong to the group that indeed looked at it that we needed and we must look at the Nigerian constitution once and for all. And that's the PRONACO. And we sat down, we looked at all the problems, and we preferred solution, and of course started agitating for a sovereign national conference. And midway...
You had one in 2014.
That one is a hijacked, is a tea-free idea, if I would say it. And you saw what happened. It did not come out with the expected outcome. For starters, those who peopled the 2014 National Conference were all hand-picked and friends of government, not the people themselves. The ethnic nationalities were out of it. And we can't continue like this. And for crying out loud, we can't. You see, if the truth is not told, we'll continue to wallow in falsehood. And falsehood will continue to lead us to where we are going. Until we sit down together and look at it, just as we discussed a few seconds ago, the Ijaws or the people in the Niger that believe that, yes, or whatever comes from the oil region is theirs. Whereas your own side of Nigeria, you are not part of them, but you too, you produce oil. The same thing in Ondo State. Are they Niger Delta? Well, that is Yoruba land. The same
thing. Ondo State is in Niger Delta.
It's not in Niger Delta, it's in Yoruba. Ondo State is Yoruba. But be that as it may,
they are in NDDC.
They are in NDDC by virtue of that oil producing state, but they are not Niger Delta. They are in Yoruba state. So we have to sit down and look at all these issues. They are in the Yoruba region. So you see, once you now start turning things around, you see black, you call it white, just because of sentiment, this is what will lead. And that's why, for all intents and purposes, people who have no intention, people who have no idea, and people who want to benefit from the rot, from the gap, as we call it, lacuna, will take advantage. And that's what the politicians do, particularly members of the National Assembly. They've seen a cesspit. They've seen a route. Like the Yorubas will say, if the wall does not break, there is no way the lizard will go in. This is an opportunity. Is it only in Nigeria that we have members of the National Assembly? Is it only in Nigeria that we have a constitution? But why is it that it is every year? These ones too, they have just started. They have not even sat down. That's Saraki and Dogara. They've set up.
They've constituted 88 members.
Because there is money there to chop. If Buhari is holding their hands, no Ghana must go when they were approving the ministers. Then this is another area where nobody can hold us. So this is our work. And they are doing it with impunity. And that's just it.
Let me ask Magneza, what are some of those lacunas in the Constitution? Because would really need amendment. From your legal perspective, what you were taught in school in constitution drafting and the rest. Some of us, laymen, would tell you that, look, if anything is wrong with the constitution, there is a place to go and test it instead of the everyday amendment. Why is, the constitution not being tested in the courts?
Let me say that I don't think I want to agree with the assertion that the constitution is not being tested in the courts. I don't think so. I have always been of the opinion that when people come around and criticize a document, I don't think criticism should be just for its own sake. If you have read Matthew Arnold's The Victorian Essays, The Function of Criticism at the Present Time, Matthew Arnold says that if a poet is a dubious classic, let us sit him. If he's a false classic, let us explode him. But if he's a true classic, of course, that is the meaning of classic. So when people come around and bandy arguments about, this constitution has problem, whatever, I think that, it should be the responsibility of those of us who are in the media. Let me say that I'm a media practitioner before I became a legal practitioner. It should be our responsibility to get to the facts of the matter. What are the areas, gray areas in this constitution that we can identify? My colleague had just mentioned the fact that certain parts of Nigeria belong to certain ethnic groups. The question is that from Africa, if you look at the constitutional history from 1914 to 1922 to 1946 to 1951 to 1954 to 1960 and so on, you find out that the question is that where is the focus of Africa as a continent? The forefathers who fought for the independence of Nigeria and for us to have the kind of constitution you eventually had, what was their vision? What was Zeke thinking about? And then you look at the cultural attitude of the people, you find out that the reaction in post-colonial era was that, this is what the colonialists have done for us. And you see it in the title of the book they have written, Walter Rodney, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, Chinua Achebe, things for
that. Isn't it even Africans that are underdeveloping Africa now?
Let my people go, cry the beloved country, all sort of lamentation. The question is that, a paper I presented at the University of Benin in 2014, about the fact that the falsity of post-colonial theory is that where we want to lay blame on the past of the colonialists when they were here, they were this and that, like Achebe were starting things fall apart, they came here, they brought a knife, they tore the rope that tied us together. But the question is that after 50 years after they had left, have we been able to put something together? And that led me to the article I wrote in one of my columns in Daily Independent. Zoning formula, wrong calculus, unbalanced equation. Because at the end of the day, the question we want to ask ourselves is that what is wrong with our constitution, or what is wrong with the spirit that's operating the constitution? I'm happy this is the pastor here. The Bible's Jesus.
He's a lawyer.
Yes, he's a lawyer. He's a lawyer.
When he's on set.
Yeah, he's a lawyer. He's a lawyer. Yes. But I'm just saying that, in a religious society also, you want to talk to our people with the semiotics of religion.
What has religiosity got to do?
Now, what I'm trying to say,
lay your foundation.
When Christ says that it's the letter killeth, but it's the spirit that giveth life. All right. So essentially, my attitude had always been that when I did constitutional law in the university, my opinion is that Nigeria has always been having one or two things to address in their constitution. But essentially, can we please take our focus? Can we focus on the spirit behind the constitution? Now, this constitution identified three types of citizenship. You're either a citizen by birth, or by registration, or by naturalization. And when you are a citizen of Nigeria by birth, it means that any of your grandparents or either of your parents belongs to a community that is indigenous to Nigeria. And I think I canvassed that the last time I came here. I.e. that you cannot divorce your Nigerianness from being your Yorubaness or being Igbo or being Isoko. You cannot divorce them. Now, if you had enough time to read Obafemi Awolowo talks on Nigerian constitution, you will see that his idea of state creation was on the basis of linguistic and cultural contiguity. I.e. that you have to know exactly what are the value system of these people and then evolve therefrom. Not because you want to balkanize ourselves, because at the end of the day, if Africans, if what's Marcus Mosiah Garvey, you know, in his back to Africa ship, named called the Black Moses, if the idea of the Black Renaissance is for us to project this continent, because Africa had been replete when you go to read some of Soyinka's works. The Lauren Gbagbos, the Sanko, the Sonny Abacha, Nigeria, Africa had been unlucky to have the not so right kind of leadership. And I think that, so if you want to look at the constitutional framework as, you know, what is wrong with us, then let us look at the areas. Are we looking at Section 308 of this constitution, for instance, that granted immunity to people who are, you know that section applies? All right? Are we considering it from the point of, do we say that we should remove the immunity clause? Against the backdrop of the teaching of someone like Professor S. A. Doe Smith, that talks about the fact that government must not be left as vulnerables in the hand of meddlesome interlopers and professional litigants. Are we looking at it from that point of view? Now, that's what I'm saying. That so when the media is here to beam such light on issues of national discourse like this, we should do the utmost to make sure that our people are enlightened, so that when we say something is wrong with our constitution, the American constitution, for instance, if you are in the House of Representatives, you know, you are supposed to live in your constituency. There are certain number of people that must be, certain population, that you have to represent, that determines your representation. And then when you look at the size of Nigeria, Nigeria is geographically the size of Texas. And despite the fact that Nigeria has, Nigeria is just the size of Texas, we have 36 states, 36 governors, retinue of officers, and whatever. And I think that if we can have a conference, sovereign or not, or no sovereign, that can let us go back to certain drawing boards with respect to regionalism. When Obafemi Awolowo, when I was doing a photocopy at biochemistry department or biology department of Obafemi Awolowo University, all right, at a point in time, and I looked at the number, the amount of money, the budget it took the man for him to put Obafemi Awolowo University together in his lifetime. And time was in this country when the southwestern part of Nigeria produces cocoa, Ghana produces cocoa, Brazil produces cocoa, but at the same time, we are not on the same plane today. So the question is that in our national life, is anything wrong with our constitution? If the answer is yes, where are the areas? Where are the areas we need to touch on the constitution? And if somebody said that he has spent X amount of money on reviewing the constitution, the question to ask is that, how does that happen, you know, bit by bit? How do we get into those areas? And I think that it's only when we are just being radical and fundamental about analysis of our, you know, the way our national life, that we really can make a headway.
Wale, the being radical and being fundamental about the 1999 constitution as amended led to the former president not assenting to some of the amendments. Take, for example, let me have a quick read here, where they said the national, despite the huge public funds, purportedly expended on the amendment, Mr. Jonathan refused to sign the amendment into law. Instead, he on April 13 wrote to the National Assembly complaining of defects in the bill. A National Assembly then threatened to override his veto within 30 days. And this same section was part of the amendment that the National Assembly had passed to him. The issue of the veto power, the issue that such a bill after 30 days automatically becomes law.
It's a matter of ego. And that's what I guess my brother was trying to go to, national interest or personal interest. And of course, there's the individual
interest.
Well, unfortunately, that's what has happened. It is the individual interest that superseded that of a national interest, because he was the head of state and the president. despite the colossal amount of money wasted or spent on that project, just because of ego, that project did not see the light of the day. Unfortunately, people like us never believed. I was one of those who were against that, the process. You remember that a whole lot of money was wasted because the 360 members of the National the House of Representatives were busy carrying out and conducting constituency meetings.
Yeah, all in 360. Over.
In 360 constituencies.
The same thing the in Senate. The Senate.
And I told them then that it's just going to be a wasteful journey.
And here we are. Sorry. And
from
most,
the onset. And the same thing will befall this one. This one that they just set up. Because they know where they are going. And where they are going will end up crushed. Because it's a lie. The fundamental thing is that the people must be allowed. And it's a simple thing. I've promoted it and I've propounded it
how
a long time ago.
How simple is constitutional?
It's as simple as where I'm going now.
Yeah.
We all know that there are ethnic nationalities all over. If you go to Ijebode, you know the people who belong to, who are the Jebus in Ijebode and Shagam and Remo and Peru get it and Mushi
Ikene.
These are the Jebu people. Then the people who they call them the villagers around the Jebu area, they come. You say, okay, we are meeting. If everyone has its own, they know the geographical headquarters. You leave that, you go to Ekiti. All the Ekitis, there is no Ekiti. Is he Ado? Is he Ilawe? Is he Ise? Is he Emure? Is he Aramoko? They all of them Ekitis. They group themselves. Is he your backyard, your place? Is he Irua? Is he Gwebe? Is he Ora? Is it where is it now?
Ibanke.
Is he Ibilo? All of them. That's the Edo area this side. Is it your area, Saple, Wari, Burutu, Patani, Ugende?
Is that the kind of pattern, you know, when you're talking of people, when
you're talking of... These people now, the people who aggregate the various town hall meetings will come from one level to the other. Not that somebody will sit in Abuja and handpick, oh, Ogodo, you are from Saple, you go there. Hey, you are from Kiru, you go there. You are not in reality. You are not a grassroots person. Those who people the place, they are not grassroots. They are people who live in Abuja, who live in Lagos, or who live in Port Harcourt. I now tell them to aggregate the views of the rural man, who feels a pinch, who has nothing to show. As I talk to you now, if you go to, the other day, I was in Okwawa in Ijebode, the local government there, behind the Ijebode there. The houses that I saw 40 years ago are still there, dilapidated. The road, everywhere. There's no government, what was it now?
Presence
there. And it continues. And you say there should not be rural urban drift. What is my cousins that are growing up in the rural area, you want them to die old and wretched when there is nothing to develop them? Whereas a country like India, government deliberately sets up industries in the rural area to promote rather urban-rural migration. Constitution. The government in the constitution, there is a deliberate policy for rural development, which is justiciable. In this country, nothing like that. And I'm talking to you now as a constitutional lawyer. I've done research of various countries. How did they develop? Through the constitution, through deliberate policy of integrating the people. And the people must, government is there for the people. Not the people for government. Not that because you now get the opportunity of becoming the president. Unfortunately, in Nigeria, the president has that octopotic power, you know, an octopus, with so many fingers and hands. So it muzzles you together.
I had some for lunch yesterday.
So, that is what the system is all about, and that's what the problem. And all these greedy politicians, particularly members of the National Assembly, they have seen it. And until the Nigerian people, and that's where the press comes in, to support us, the activists, that indeed, the only way we can get out of this vicious circle is for us to have a sovereign national conference where all the nationalities, not some hand-picked people.
Are you going to go to court to stop this process again?
We are working on it. I won't let the cat out of the bag. We are working on it. We look. You see, we have tried it sometime. We failed because the way we went to court.
You couldn't get it.
Yes. And we want to look at it this time around. We want to see how we can go around it. And we're still working on it.
The 88 members committee has been inaugurated.
Yeah, they can be inaugurated. They can start work. We have no problem.
Money would have been voted.
No, if money is voted before they get there, well, don't worry. Don't worry. We'll see what we'll do. We can't continue like this. I just tell you, you see? Okay, like now, everybody is shouting, Nigeria is bad, Nigeria is bad, Nigeria is bad. Nigeria didn't get worse today. When they were sharing dollars on the streets of Lagos some few months ago, didn't you know that it will affect Nigeria tomorrow? The same thing now. Let's tell us the truth. People were picking dollars. They were giving people dollars, and people were taking it. You don't know that it will have effect today. How about?
Magnesia,
yes.
Is the Nigerian constitution such a laborious or gargantuan, you know, work of law that is causing all these divisions? Okay, but please, before you take that answer, that let's quickly go on break now, because we have one commercial or two, some messages actually to take. So you just stay with us and join us again.
Is it what crazy? Or talk crazy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
Things making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, tribal looters.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face. Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to discipline. I said, well, help
on
me.
On Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
For topical issues, Nigerians must have something to say.
Arms, we don't need arms for anything. Let them put it into education.
They need to buy another arms now.
What are they fighting for?
Wait, who?
Government should deal with them squarely.
Please, help us bring back our girls.
No money, no markets. We are dying. Everybody is crying. Nothing, nothing.
Any man God support, no man stops.
It's a prophecy I believe he must have received from heaven. Yes!
The people giving voice to the voiceless.
Every day, every hour, and every minute, news break in Nigeria. Things happen so fast, it's most times difficult to track and comprehend them. But that's what we do right here on Digi 360.
2015, would you want to come back again?
It's like asking Jesus Christ if he knew he was going to die, will you want to come back as the savior of the world again?
We do not just help you track the stories, we break them down, explore all the angles, analyze the issues so that you can fully comprehend the stories and use them to make the right decisions.
Welcome back, and you're still on to Core TV News in Lagos and the program Core Digest. Our topic today, Constitution Amendments, the unending bazaar. Before I go on to asking the unending bazaar and before the break, I was asking how omnibus is the Nigerian constitution that, you know, does it create a lot of problem in the polity as it is?
I sincerely don't think so, because I think that the document we have to work with, this is the constitution. The constitution identifies itself as the supreme law of the land. So section 1, subsection 3 of the constitution talks about the supremacy of the constitution. And if you are talking about, it says, since that particular section I've just quoted, it says, if any law is inconsistent with the provisions of this constitution, this constitution shall prevail,
yeah,
and that other law shall, to the extent of its inconsistency, be void.
Mm-hmm.
And so, to that extent, subsidiary legislations and laws of states and whatever, they come under the umbrella of the constitution.
Yeah.
I think for the purpose of law and order, stricto sensu, I don't think the omnibus supervention of the constitution over other legislation, I don't think is too unwieldy. I don't think so.
So, then, wouldn't you say since 1999 to date, about 20 billion naira in every assembly's wanting to amend the constitution?
Well,
that's a huge jamboree. That's why I said
earlier on that we have to be able to identify exactly what we are talking about. Are we talking about kleptomania? Are we talking about crime? Are we talking about corruption? Is the constitution the problem itself? Answer is no to me. It's about the people. It's about the operators of the constitution. That's why I try to distinguish between the letters and the spirit of the constitution.
Mm.
The intent of the constitution is for better government at any point in time. All right? But when individual practitioners of politics, you know, of anything, gets into government and they begin to conduct themselves in an unseemly way, I don't think the constitution should be blamed for that. And so that's why I'm trying to say that over time, Africa has to look at itself holistically, and that's why I feel that our generation here, when they talk about, the other time we're talking about the issue of crime, issue of kidnapping, and generation problem, all right? The question is that the better part of the people who fought for the independence of Nigeria were in their prime, as at the time they did that. Achebe wrote Things Fall Apart at the age of 28. And he created an Okonkwo who, to all intent and purpose, will be an usurped title holder in his society. A 28-year-old boy, young man, writing that. Soyinka wrote The Interpreters at the age of 31. So people were particularly productive, and that's why I said Soyinka was rather being apocalyptic by describing his own generation as wasted generation. Now, if you want to talk about the problems of the constitution, what are the areas of the constitution that we're having problem with? Is it about the fiscal federalism? Is it that there is no direct fiscal relationship between the local government and the federal government? What are the separation of powers, horizontally and vertically? How do we enforce that? If you go to chapter 2 of the Nigerian constitution that talks about fundamental objectives and directive principles of state policy, and the fact that it is not justiciable, how can we make those things happen in our generation? And that's why I feel that in our analysis, having been in the media myself for the better part of my post-first degree, I feel that the media owes it a duty to ensure that when we are getting issues of national discourse across our people, we have to be didactic, we have to be teaching them, we have to look at how do we get to the problem of the society. The militants that are the Tompolos and whatever in the society today didn't just happen overnight. And if you are looking at, if you want to address the problem of rural urban migration, which my learned colleague has just mentioned earlier on, we have to be radical, we have to be fundamental about it. If you read Kanye Agari's award-winning Yellow, for instance, he talks about the fact that most girls in the Niger Delta at the age of 17, 11 will have had two or three children by different fathers before they begin to think about university, because of the expatriate influence and whatever. So essentially, I think that, like I said, that if I had had the opportunity of going to the National Conference of 2014, which I had aspired to, I would have gone there to canvass for a cultural revolution in which there is no section, there's no culture that is seen to be more important than another. If you read Obafemi Awolowo's thoughts on Nigerian constitution, you talk about the majority, you talk about the minority, and that informed my article when I talk about the minority of majority and majority of minority, because at the end of the day, if you actually put the minorities together, they are more than the majority put together. So, and then when you talk about leaders, when you talk about, the Learned Council had just mentioned the issue of getting to the rural areas, taking people's opinion. Desmond Tutu was the first French philosopher to discuss the idea of ideology. He defines ideology as a science of ideas. And he says that there has to be intellectual faculty for people to be able to give their citizens good governance. You see that in Obafemi Awolowo, for instance. Obafemi Awolowo, when he was premier of Western Region, made sure that the rural environment, there were rubber plantations in Araromi Obu. People didn't have to move out of their village to come to the city. You understand? You didn't have any business coming to Ibadan. All right? Olunloyo was one of the kingmakers in Ibadan. Was a commissioner for education in those days. All right? When they come visiting our schools in Ondo Grammar School and stuff like that, they had this halo of intellect around them. And there was discipline. So I think that My own concern as a commentator on television or radio is the fact that, first of all, we are Africans. And if at the end of the day we begin to atomize ourselves, is Igbo, is Isoko, is Yoruba, whatever, whatever, you know, I'm not saying that we shouldn't recognize our own entity. I went to Abuja, for instance, and I was talking to a lady at the restaurant, and she told me that she's a Gbagi. It was then I know that the Gbagi people, actually, and then I watched their, you know, their clippings on television. I found out that they have similarity with the, you know, with the Kanuri and the Yorubas. So as much as possible, God has given us a rainbow of cultures on this continent. And all we can do in our generation is to ensure that we get ourselves good governance. And the last article, one of the last articles I wrote was Wonderful World, Beautiful People, Ugly Religions. Africa has been so brainwashed. You understand what I'm saying? If you read Olodumare God in Yoruba Belief by Professor Bolaji Igbo, for instance, he tells us that there is nobody anywhere in the world that God had never revealed himself to at any point in time. So it wasn't the Jews or the Arabs that came to show us God. Yeah, it wasn't. Ajayi Crowther, for him to be able to translate the English Bible into Yoruba, had to go into terminology to be able to do that. So what I'm saying essentially is that for a new generation, MacPherson, for instance, when he was doing his own, when he was going to, you know, put his own 1951 constitution together, there were layers, about 5 layers of consultation with the villagers, with the districts, with the divisionals, with the provincial, with the regions, to be able to put something together for us. We have seen all those things. So we have no reason to want to fail our generation. And that is why we have to be able to enlighten our people within the precinct of the fact that they have to know exactly where the rain began to be then. Where are we coming from as Africans? Because, you know, when you go into profile of, issue of what section 131 in this constitution that talked about qualification for presidency, I contested election into National Assembly in 2007 with Femi Gbajabiamila in the same constituency. And when we went to Birial Avenue for certificate verification, I went there with my certificate, laminated from primary 6 to master's degree, 2 bachelor's degree. You understand what I'm saying? And when you get there, I mean, when I got to that place, the guy said, man, for the first time I'm seeing this thing live and direct. People didn't acquire education just for its own sake. They did that so that they can, you know, ensure a betterment for
society.
And so when we are talking about amending constitution, if we cannot continue to blame all those colonial plans now for not being able to take care of ourselves. What Achebe said in No Longer to Respect to Bribery and Corruption, what Shoyinka said about corruption in the interpreters, that's what we're experiencing here. And so we have to be passionate, and when we have human rights activists like our council here, it should be the urge to make sure that the first thing our people need is the pedagogy of politics. Let them know exactly where they're coming from. Obafemi Awolowo, 55, 10 years after the Second World War, Obafemi Awolowo introduced free education in western part of Nigeria. And when you go into World University News, Professor Tunde Fatunde Olasu is one of the correspondents, you will find out that the rating is that in all parts of Africa today, there is nowhere in all Africa where you can travel 50 kilometers without seeing a university, except southwestern part of Nigeria. That's an Awolowo. You understand what I'm saying? So we need a holistic thinker, philosopher king like Plato, who can pass for.
Yeah.
And then when CCECC were constructing my 12 and Ikorodu Road, you go and see the truck they are using. Every pin that manufactures in China. That was because we had the dialectics of materialism that was flowered by, you know, nurtured by the Karl Marx, the Nikolai Lenin, and Mao Zedong, you know, coming, originating from that part of the world. So we have to sit ourselves down and ask ourselves specific questions without being partisan, without looking at anybody. Go straight to the issue. What is our problem in this continent as Africans? And in our generation, if Shoyinka says his own generation is wasted, can we really give an excuse for failing our own generation? The beautiful ones are not yet born. Things fall apart. Cry the beloved country. Weep not child. That's our lamentation in the sisters. Can we continue to lament like that? Answer to me is no. And I think that every Nigerian listening to us and watching us should be passionate about the fact that we have to be responsible as a people.
Can we really stop the lamentations with a kind of colossal amount that has gone into, you know, the constitution amendments in Nigeria and not really getting any headway to the detriment of the people or for the benefit of the people?
Well, maybe I'll change my cap again now from being a lawyer to an advocate and an activist. And as the lamentation can only stop when the right people are there. It is when people who have a fear of God are in authority, that's when the people will enjoy. And I've found out with my own little interaction with the people over the years that people too like to be sold a dummy called lie. You see, the elections are coming. Most of the time, maybe during the elections, I'm in my official kit, maybe as an election observer, and you find people asking me, "Oga, we are own share. Share of what? To come out and vote the right person that will make your country better?" And now let's look at it. As I'm talking to you now, we operate a set of laws called the 1914 Laws of Federation, recycled till now. That's why all these people that are being moved up and down for corruption and so on go away with a slap in the wrist. In other countries, they have engineered the law. They say that, okay, it is stealing government money that makes people emboldening people because there is no adequate punishment. They look at the appropriate punishment. I tell you, as an activist, I will not advocate killing by the death penalty, but you can go as far as confiscating their houses. These people that have stolen, you take them around all the schools, particularly in their village, where they come from.
They call that shame them, name and shame them.
And you throw small children.
That used to exist. These people, the
law is no more there. That's where I'm going. So the lawmakers are the ones, at the end of the day, they will start shouting on us lawyers and activists that we are the cause of this problem. No. It's the lawmakers. You can't just go and make law anyhow. It is the lawmakers that will make the law for a better society. That's the essence of the National Assembly by virtue of Section 7 of the 1999 Constitution. Right. So if they are there, they want to make law and they can't make the law, our law that are appropriate, our people who people this law, this National Assembly, don't have the fear of God. They know that instead of they amending the Constitution appropriately, it is the money that they are going to make that is behind it, not the end result. Obviously, my brother is talking here. He has all those degrees and he will be sidelined. It is somebody who is less qualified that will be taken just because they know that that one will compromise. That's another thing. Another issue, coming to the issue of voters themselves. Election time is coming. Nobody cares about the pedigree and the antecedent of that person who is bringing you money to vote for him. And the person has bought your vote. Do you think he will be part of those that will make a good law to fight against your corruption?
That's the cultural value Magnesia said we've lost.
So, if that cultural value is lost, there won't be that lamentation. There will continue to be lamentation in the land because you have already eaten your cake.
And you can't have it.
You can't have it. So I hope those who are watching, this is a very good time, and I thank God for this opportunity, that people will begin to think ahead. That are we going to continue this way? Is it only in Nigeria that we have constitutions or laws? Is it only in Nigeria that we have a set of lawmakers? Is it only in Nigeria that we have elections? It's only in Nigeria that there will be an election and there will be wahala. In Ghana, I've monitored the election in Zimbabwe.
Don't they go to the tribunal?
They don't. After the election, Shikin and everybody goes home. The elections is there. They know. Everyone knows. But in Nigeria, you know, they will deliberately rig it and say, meet us in court, because they know that they, the politicians too, they have made the court system to be skewed, that for 4 years that you spend there, you are in court and they are enjoying taking money. But in a country like South Korea, 2 weeks, everything is finished. Even commercial practice. All this, in fact, I'm surprised. I learned that the Dasuki team of lawyers, they say that they are going to stall the trial of Dasuki. And there is a law called the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, 2015,
yeah,
that forbids such thing, and the lawyers know it, and they want to do it in this country, and nobody will say, no, why are you people doing this?
So you lawyers are part of the problems too. It's not just the legislators.
So where I'm going is that it's because we know that whatever we do, everybody goes, but when there is a punitive action that, no, you know this thing is wrong and you have done it, you are punished for it, people will put their hands in their pocket. But because the era of impunity, people do things anyhow, we will continue to lament. And I'm addressing the issue of lamentation. I will continue to lament until we refer to Isaiah 5:20. We say, woe unto him who sees white and call it black.
Yeah.
Woe, that's what the Bible says.
Mm.
I rest my case.
Well, Wale Ogunade has added some religious bent to it, but let me again, you know, tickle our viewers with this, that withdrawals continued again, for were made long even after the other committee of the Constitution Review Committee of the National Assembly had submitted their final reports to both chambers for consideration, and even a few weeks before the general elections and the inauguration of the 8th National Assembly. Take for example, the Senate committee was statutorily charged by the Deputy Senate President Ike Ekweremadu, while the House committee was headed by, while the House committee, of course, was headed by the then Deputy Speaker Emeka Iedioha, the one that failed governorship election in Imo State. Let me give you again some of the withdrawals that were made. The National Assembly, for example, was not in session when certain withdrawals on February 20th, 2014 was made. It withdrew 250 million naira. Another 250 million on May 27th, 2014. Another 250 million on August 21, 2014. 166.5 million naira on a date not specified, and 83.5 million naira on December 5th, 2014.
And that's Christmas bonus.
Yeah, then look at this. The committee further withdrew 83.8 million naira on March 2nd, 2015. And the same amount on March 23rd, 2015, that was 5 days before the presidential and National Assembly election.
And that's for their election.
And on April 13th, barely 2 days after this year's governorship election, that is 2015. Can you see the cesspool? Are this, or were these people then and now really interested in amending the constitution for the good of the people, or is the money involved?
Well, I think that question is that sounds more like a rhetorical question to me. The answer is there. It's obvious. It's not latent. It's patent. So to me, I feel that we when we have an opportunity like this, it's a lot of cultural reawakening to tell our people. All right, when you begin to see a Tompolo, all right, at a point in time, gangsterism became a norm for heroism in Africa.
Yeah,
it became heroism. Mm-hmm. The kind of heroes we had. Mm. All right, I remember when you read Akide Years of Childhood, you see how a Shurika as a young man.
Oh yeah,
you want to go and listen to Nnamdi Azikiwe.
Oh yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? You had to listen to them. You go with your books and whatever. Mm. And Chinua Achebe's, the British protected child. You read all those things and you see how it was like.
How that people time. Developed.
Right? Now the question is that, can we put our history in perspective and begin to analyze exactly the coup on Zogu? Was it a service to this country or a disservice? Because those guys that were killed, they were assassinated at that time.
Mm.
I mean, when you...
They turned out to be saints now.
They're saints now, because when you get
Tafa to Bauchi... Tafa had nothing.
In 1989, it was 1989 when we founded AWON, Arthritis Organization of Nigeria, and we were in Sugiji Hotel. And I went to
the Masiluam.
You get there, you see the transistor, you see a very...
About 2 years ago, very austere.
All right, up till now, when you get to see Shehu Shagari, you see Shagari returning to his plantation, you know, going to till the ground. Most of those generals, ABM, Haruna, whatever, they are back to land, they are back into farming, because we grew up and we were nurtured in those values.
Mm.
Schools are established in Lagos today without the proprietor knowing next to nothing about curriculum development. So, you know, it's a whole lot of things. So that when we graduate to a political level, in which everything is topsy-turvy, all right? Up until we begin to address issues from the fundamental basis of family, for instance. Who is a father? Who is supposed to be a mother? What is the responsibility of a father? What are family values? What do they teach in primary schools? When we're in primary school, they will teach us about GF or Dunjo and recite some Yoruba verse. That will teach us some morals. All right? It's no longer that. Before you could have a school in those days, you are supposed to have a site for farm. You are supposed to have a field for psychomotor development. But those things are no longer there. So to the extent that, so when characters now begin to handle constitution and they talk about the constitution, I just feel that, you know, it's like what Mark Antony said in Julius Caesar. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. Mm. So the fault to me is not in the constitution, it's in the people that are operating the constitution. And that is why we have to, if you are going to leave anything behind for our generation, the other time, like I said, they were interviewing me on television during the big battle when General Babangida, former President Babangida, was marking 70. And there was a big battle of exchange between himself and former President Olusegun Obasanjo over who was responsible for what.
Yes.
And indeed. I said, if you divide 70 by 2, you get 35. Mm. That was the age Martin Luther King won the Nobel in America. Mm. And he was the youngest up until this Malala girl won at 17.
Yeah.
And when you interview Malala, what did Malala say about him, about what she was going to do with the money? She told you that this is what I want to do.
Mm.
So the national consciousness is there. So when you go into the history of African nationalism, where you are talking about Shaka the Zulu, you are talking about Mzilikazi, South Africa, how did we get to where we are? And up until we begin to really look at what were those values?
Do we really, you see, that brings me to a very serious subject.
Yes.
Who are those who built Nigeria? Do we really have any people who built the country called Nigeria? Because remember,
yes,
your history very well.
Yes.
Nigeria came into existence in 1914.
Yes.
If you look at the Zigs, you look at Ahmadu Bello, you look at Awolowo, you look at Okotiebo, all those, even look at what's the name of the progenitor now that started the NCNC then?
Herbert Macaulay.
Yeah, Herbert Macaulay. Yes. These were people who came before 1914. So nobody, some school of thought will say, nobody built Nigeria. That's why we are what we are.
When we talk about nation building,
it's exactly what I am saying. Because in America, you can point to the fault.
Even when you talk about nation building,
yeah,
like the council just mentioned about engineers who wanted to construct a story building without a landing.
Mm.
You understand what I'm saying? Even when you talk about nation building is not an architectural masterpiece that is well laid out and is set out to be built.
They're accidental.
It's a process.
It's a process.
All right?
Yeah.
Time was where you have to listen to this. If you go and read, I teach American literature. And when I teach American literature, I teach Thomas Paine.
Yeah.
When you read Thomas Paine, you read Thomas Jefferson, you read Benjamin Franklin, the guy who discovered the thunder wire and who also was one of the signatories to the three documents that made America.
Mm.
They were thinkers. At a time in this country where we were talking about nationalism, you had classes of writers meeting together, the Christopher Okigbos, the Wole Soyinkas, the J.P. Clarks, or having to meet at certain sections, and they begin to criticize themselves on issue of nation building. Philosophies are developed like that. And up until people begin to get to that level, those things no longer happen. People don't hang out amongst themselves to discuss their poems, their writings, and they have intellectual exchanges.
Let me just interject here.
Okay.
And I want to bless you and bless God for your life. I guess that's the problem. You just hit the nail on the head. Nigeria has no founding father, and that's why the problem we have here. Nkrumah, Ghana.
You liken him to the founding father of Ghana?
Here in Nigeria, when they want to mention Nigeria, they will be mentioned three people. Mm. And if three persons cannot be a father of somebody, you'll be having problems. That is the problem of Nigeria. Now, if they want to look at it in South Africa, they will be mentioning Nelson Mandela as the father of that nation. Do I need to go
far? Who is the father of Nigeria?
Nobody. And that's your problem. And that's why we have this crisis. That is just it, my brother. When you ask that question, I say that's the problem we've had. And I'll tell you, we'll begin to move a movement for us to have a new nation. Unfortunately, Obasanjo, when he became the president, looked at it that he's the father of a new Nigeria. But along the line, he deviated and missed it. If there is no father figure anywhere, obviously, you know what I'm talking about. I know, as a lawyer, I've related with women. who are single mothers.
Yeah.
And you know that they have problems with their children, particularly male children, who now become wayward. Even if I'm not at home, once I get home, I know how the children now behave. They'll say, there is a need for a father figure in the house.
Oh, okay, would continue on that line of discourse. Would go on another short break, and when we return, we're going to open our lines. But after this time out, you join us again.
The Federal Inland Revenue Service, FIRS, calls on all corporate organizations operating in Nigeria to register for the purpose of payment of taxes and obtain a tax identification number, TIN. All registered companies must obtain a tax identification number immediately from the nearest FIRS office. You can also collect and return tax registration forms from the Federal Inland Revenue Service Engagement and Enlightenment Tax Teams, FEET, on compliance checks exercise in your area. A company which is yet to commence business after at least 6 months of incorporation must pay a pre-operational levy of 20,000 Naira in the first year and 25,000 Naira for subsequent years to obtain its tax clearance certificate, TCC. Note that filing and payment of VAT and withholding tax returns must be done on or before the 21st day of every month. Register for VAT. File all tax returns as and at when due. Be a responsible corporate citizen of Nigeria. It pays to pay your tax. This message is from the Federal Inland Revenue Service.
Chima, what did they do so?
Same market now, they are collecting.
Hey, but see when they buy the market, no get a receipt. What did they do?
Which receipt? No be pocket money they go.
Hey, you didn't pay tax.
Who be tax?
Me? Guy, all these health centers where they run, now tax you.
My brother make I tell you.
Good road, now tax.
Security, now tax.
Those school where your children they go, how you think say them they take pay the teachers? Brother, na tax. And if you not pay your tax, my brother, then go lock your shop.
Tunde, where did they pay the tax?
Na for tax office now.
Carry me go there.
Who go?
Abu, I just look shop, I beg.
You can now watch Core TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.coretvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Core TV Primetime News.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook. And YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Core TV, leave a space, then news. Core TV News, a 24-hour news station.
All right, you welcome back, and you're still on to Core TV News in Lagos, the program called Digest. If you're just joining us, well, you've not missed so much. Our topic is constitution amendments, the unending jamboree. I was tempted to call it bazaar there. We're now going to open our line to our team in viewers within and outside Nigeria. You can call us on 0816-481-8001. It's right on your screen there, but let me quickly again, for the benefit of others who probably are not sighted, it's 0816-481-8001. Call us, and please kindly remember that when you are making your calls, you should turn down the volume of your TV set. If you don't, it's going to interfere with our communication and it will be difficult to hear you. I don't think you want us to cut you off. We want to hear your comment. Wale, we're talking about the father figure in Nigeria. Lord Lugard probably is the father figure of Nigeria.
He's not the father of Nigeria. He's not.
He amalgamated Nigeria.
No, don't let us go there. Let's leave that one alone. Because
the wife even got us our first national
that's
anthem.
That's where I'm going. In other countries, the Europeans got there, but they had father figures who are locals. I'm talking of Tanzania now. We have in the Mwalimu, Julius Nyerere. We're talking of Emperor Haile Selassie.
of Ethiopia.
We're talking of Jomo Kenyatta in Kenya. We're talking of
Kenneth Kaunda.
Zambia shall be free. There are so many. We can't talk about it. Look, the South Africans are not proud of Ian Smith. You can't call him the father figure, but they rely around
on Sisulu, on later
even
Mandela.
This Mandela, the Madiba. Mm. So in Nigeria, there was divided interest. We are like bastards. The Igbos will look at
isn't
in,
that rather too hard?
No, that, let's look. You see, my problem is let's call it spade a spade so that we know and everybody sit up. The Igbos will look at their Nnamdi Azikiwe. The Yoruba will look at the Awolowo, and the Hausas will look at the Sadauna. That's all. And till today, it's still happening. Except you want to tell me, look at it now. The fight about corruption is sectional law. It's sectional law. It's because it's our people.
Some people are calling for a public demonstration in support
that,
of
letting steal is his money, is our money. Haba! Once there is nobody who will give us that national direction, then definitely we'll continue to have these problems.
Is that, you know, a socio-political degeneracy that, you know, has taken root in this kind of mindless jamboree or bazaar, some commentators would want to call it, that we see in an unending constitution amendment?
Well, I think I would rather take the position that we have founding fathers, but we become wayward prodigals along the line. Ojukwu made a statement, which is very, very important to our national life, i.e. when Obafemi Awolowo died. He said Obafemi Awolowo was the best.
Oh, okay, just a moment. I think we got Clement from Kaduna State. Good morning, Clement. Hello, good morning, Clement. Well, I don't think Clement has adhered.
Hello.
Clement, you've not adhered to my instruction
hello.
Here. Yeah, hello, good morning, Clement.
I am not hearing you.
Yeah, that's because you've not turned down the volume of your TV set. Turn it down completely. All right, Clement, are you still with us? Okay, I think we've lost that. Please, once again, let me appeal to our viewers calling in that you must first turn down the volume of your TV set. You cannot listen to yourself on TV while you're on the phone. It's not just possible at all. So it affects communications. It's either you won't be hearing me or I won't be hearing you. And then there won't be a two-way communication. And we're not ready fusions here, are we?
No.
All right, go on. Why is he expecting some of the calls?
Yes. When Obafemi Awolowo died, Ojukwu described Obafemi Awolowo as the best president Nigeria never had.
Never had, yeah.
And when you go into the writings of some of these...
Okay, I think we have another caller on the line. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
Hello.
Good morning. Can you see me gesturing?
Oh, it's are you hearing me?
I'm hearing you.
Hello?
Madu Abuchi. Yeah, I can hear you.
Hello, are you hearing me?
Yes, I am hearing you. Can you see me nod
hello?
My head?
Are you hearing me?
Very well.
Okay.
Madu Abuchi.
I want to think on... you say that Nigeria have no father.
Founding fathers.
I want to
that's
tell you that Nnamdi Azikiwe is the one that brought independence in Nigeria.
Okay.
So the problem is from the high officers in Nigeria. You're supposed to know that Nnamdi Azikiwe is the founder of Nigeria. And he's still maintaining it till he died. Hello?
We're hearing you. Round up with your contribution if you're saying...
I can't hear you.
But I'm hearing you loud and clear. I can hear you. Just go on with your contribution. We're hearing you here.
Okay. So...
Okay, that's all you probably have to say.
I think he said it all. He says Nnamdi Azikiwe, you know, gave us independence and is the founding father of Nigeria.
The Yoruba man will call in and say...
But at least our history, you know, taught us that Nnamdi Azikiwe was even a pupil under the late engineer Herbert Macaulay.
Where there are interconnectivities around in historical development of any people, the pupillage of Aristotle to Plato wasn't just an arranged thing. It was accidental. People began to think and began to express themselves, and they were exchanging ideas. You remember the crop of journalists that were founding fathers of Africa, that we can say founding fathers of Africa.
Yeah.
Much at Herbert Macaulay will mentor Nnamdi Azikiwe. So Nnamdi Azikiwe mentored Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana.
Absolutely.
Through journalism. Mm. And you see, in the process of writing and exchanging ideas, almost all those founding fathers had one or two things to do with journalism. Mm. Natif Kaode, Jack Conde, B.C. Onobanjo,
Awolowo,
Segun Oshoba. All right? Mention them. They had something to do with journalism because it's a place for public intellectuality. All right? And so, in the process of intellectualizing themselves, when Leopold Soda Senghor came with the idea of negritude, it was an issue that pervaded Africa.
Chukwuka
came and said that, look, you don't begin to, you have to act it. All right, so in the process, these people bequeathed to us.
All right, Issa from Kaduna, good morning.
Hello?
I can hear you loud and clear, Issa. Can you hear me?
Issa is calling from Kaduna.
Yes, Issa from Kaduna. Good morning and welcome to Court Digest.
To start with, let me start on Court TV. The lady you used to bring for your newscasting, the speak funnel, which we don't understand. Let them talk to them, let them speak real English, Nigerian English, so that we can understand them. And for this program this morning, I greet the two gentlemen on the stage for their contribution. And the real thing is, if Nigerian leaders will be watching your program and select those who are highly interested in developing Nigeria, like this gentleman we have here, rather than choosing people who doesn't even know what leadership is all about. So that would deliver us from the mess we are today. Just as they said here, that most of our politicians today, they were just there for money and for popular sake. So if the leaders could be watching such programs, not only Court TV, there are other programs that they bring in intellectual people. Those are the people, these kind of people can never get to the seat. They can never get to where they want by voting, because the so-called politicians will surround that seat that they will not be able to get there. So if the Nigerian will be watching this kind of program, we have those who can deliver Nigeria from Nigerians. We don't need to go to anywhere. Like what we discussed about National Assembly, this thing has been going on. This is what happened during the Abacha regime. They said all this rubbish conference, and it's starting again. As the other gentleman said, before they start, he said they are going to say, I see them as a failure. So my own advice is, apart from your program, let this kind of thing go on print media, so that people will see what we're seeing here now. That was my contribution.
Thank you very much, Issa. Gentlemen, a lot of kudos to your well-laid out thoughts, all for the benefit of the country. So we're talking of the kind of submission by Madu Buachi, you know, talking about those, you know, he claimed laid the foundation, the founding fathers.
So, and you know, at that time, the kind of leaders we had, the people who were proposing for Nigeria's independence, African independence, they were intellectuals. Leopold Soda Senghor went to Sorbonne University. the assimilation system, assimilation and absorption system of Francophone countries. Afforded him the opportunity of getting knowledge from Sorbonne.
But don't you think that system too slowed development down in the Francophone countries?
Where are you talking about?
Because you're talking of you know, cultural enslavement here.
Now. Where are you talking about? It's a contradiction in itself.
Yeah.
Because whereas the person who is assimilated into French culture is a propounder of
negritude. Yeah.
All right, and then Shoyinka comes and tells us that men, we are children.
You
of
don't
the
have
world.
To show your tigritude,
right?
You know. All
right, because people are competing.
Mm.
Time was when China was taking a backseat in international development.
Oh,
they are here competing with America.
Mm.
They are exploring space every other time. Mm. If you go to if you were at Ikorodu Road, if you are living in, you know, traveling along my 12 Ikorodu, you see that the trucks that those CCECC guys were using were made in France.
China. You know, that is Nigeria. Right.
But LCCI is asking us to leave the ban on water importation.
Leave those ones. Even the vehicle in America, the Chinese are taking over. Even the auto trade itself.
Yeah.
The auto trade, they have taken the war down to America itself. And that's what we are talking about.
Okay, we have an international caller now. Dan from Cotonou, the capital of Benin Republic. Dan, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah. Bonjour.
Yeah. I'm not a gentleman, but I'm with you there.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right.
I just want to say that one cannot change the generation of his fathers, but you can change your own generation.
Go on, Dan. Oh, what a shame.
Our generation, that's why I just made a statement some few seconds ago, that we have to look for a father figure for this country that all of us will look forward to, look up to.
I think that pot is still open to what you are talking. Yeah.
Right. So
Dan was really coming up with a very strong point there, you know, so, that if we can't change the generation of our own forebears, we can change
We need to get a father figure that will be the father of modern Nigeria, that all of us will gravitate towards, who will give us idea, who will lead us. Look at Liu Yong Chun, or what's his name now, in Malaysia. Look at this other guy too. I can't remember the name now, in Kuala Lumpur or so. Even this UAE. At least I was there some years ago. The place was a desert.
Even in Canada now, the present prime minister.
So we must have somebody.
A child when our former head of state, General Yakubu Gowon, retired.
So
went on a visit there. It was only last year's warning.
My brother, we must have somebody to look up to that will give us a sense of national direction.
Where are those to look up to?
You see,
now,
the problem
where
is
are
that
they? In you, the National Assembly?
You will be looking at somebody.
I've found my own profession. You get the point, and I'm not veering off.
No, I'm not saying you veer off. We still need, if that by being professionals, we need somebody who will be the father figure of a nation that all of us will look up to, that will give us a sense of direction. Not that the Yorubas are going to the left, the Igbos are going to the right, and the Hausas are going to the front, to the straight. No, we can't get it.
Okay.
We are pulling at each other at different levels.
Yeah, well, let's quickly speak to Clement from Kaduna. Good morning, Clement, and welcome to Core Digest.
Hello.
Good morning, Clement.
I have turned my thing down completely.
Okay, very well. Then go
if
ahead.
I hear me, just let me make my submission.
Good.
You see, the people in National Assembly are the problem. They are the problems of this country. Because if we want to make a constitution, if we say we don't need bicameral system of government, will they approve it? Of course, we don't need it. But you know that every amendment we make must affect them because they are the problem. For instance, if we say we want to put death penalty or capital punishment on corruption, it will affect 95% of them. And they will not approve it. This is the problem. Like what I was trying to say, that if we cannot change our father system. We can change ourselves. That is actually the truth. I don't want to talk something that is detrimental. How can we, civilians, change this constitution? It is just by prayer. Because these are the guys that are supposed to change the constitution. They will not. Every Nigerian knows that 90% of them are deep down into corruption. How will they change the constitution? For instance, they will say, okay, they need some numbers of vehicles for they want to work and all this, doing which to work. Do we actually need bicameral system of government? If we want to say, what is the House of Rep doing that the Senate is not doing? What is the Senate doing that the House of Rep is not doing? But money has been going in there. Nobody is talking of that. Yes, executive are corrupt. Perfect, fine. But we are made to understand that like 25% of the budget goes to the National Assembly. Less than 5,000 people. Now, if they ask them to amend that, they amend it. This is the problem we are facing. Well, we just need prayers, and we have to be very, very strong, like these two gentlemen that are here. But if we have like these people in government, we enjoy the government. But how would they get here? Like one man was saying, because they will ring them out. If my friend here now says he wants to contest, I want to be a governor, they will tell him that, who are you? They will ring him out because they know that he will never dance to their throne. That is the issue. We just need to ask and we have to be strong, my brother.
Well, thank you very much, Clement. That's Clement from Kaduna.
He's a victim.
Money issue is blighting.
And when I was a small boy, I would see money by the roadside. You just overlook it because it's not yours. That's the training, and God help you. You pick something on the road and you go home. Oh, no. You have some good beating.
I picked the wallet like that before, and I had to take it to my dad, and my dad drove me to the police station.
Uh-huh. So,
you know, I think about 6 Naira then in the good old days.
But this day, I say my wife is an educationist. The other day, she said that a boy got something that picked something, someone else's thing. Then the person now who owns it now came, and the mother was now angry that why will you now say you want to give it back?
So this moral, decadence has crept into lawmaking again.
Well, let me start by saying that I want to agree in toto with the last two speakers, Issa and Clement. Franz Fanon in The Wretched of the Earth says that every generation must, out of relative obscurity, discover its mission, betray or fulfill it. Well, we didn't have father figures, but it's high time. I can't say right now, with every sense of modesty, that I'm lacking father figure because I'm supposed to be a grandfather figure at this moment of my life.
Mm.
All right, Nigeria having come to this length of time.
Just one moment, because Franklin may just be our last caller from Kaduna State. We're getting loads of them. Hello, Franklin. Good morning, and welcome to Core Digest. Hello, Franklin. You're on, and
good morning, sir.
Yeah, very well. So, tell us, what are your thoughts about...
gentlemen, good morning. Good morning.
Morning. I can hear you, Franklin.
Yeah.
Go on, Franklin.
I appreciate your work.
Thank you.
You see, constitution. You see, this Nigeria, you understand, this Nigeria we are into, there's no truth persist in that drama.
There's
all time. When you see money in the road, you will not pick it. Mm. And that is true. It's not the same now. To see money in the road now, myself, is very, very hard because country is hard. You see, somebody will promise us that when you get there, you do such a thing, you do this thing. But when you get that place, you start packing his own money. How person a man would drive a car of 20 million? Yeah? Imagine 20 million car. Everybody, in short, both the governor, both the governor, both the House of Assembly, senators, all of them, they are thieves, sorry to say it. There's no truth testing on that thing. And we are the ones that are even voted here. You understand? This country, I don't even know what this country is into. Can't you see between what is his name? The first prime minister.
Tafawa Balewa.
I forget his name. After that man, look at the world. Can you get somebody like him? Now. You cannot get somebody like Awolu now. Or sick. Now they have to do it. You cannot get them. Everybody is entering here to eat money. And they forget that this money, you are going to leave it at that. You understand?
Very well.
Whatever you do in this world, whether it's good or good thing, people will be talking about you. And it's better than people to talk about you, concerning you, than talking about you, concerning you. You understand my point? See, everything, I know that people are listening. I know. Even though they are not listening in the TV, you don't be like a preacher man. They are preaching everywhere. The preachers is everywhere. Pastors, they are everywhere. Speaking in the radio, speaking in the TV, even in the pro, even in the most vehicle, they are speaking everywhere. They know something is good. But anything, you see, if they know that they are a good man, they will not allow you to enter that seat. Because he do not belong to them. Unless he belongs to them, they will, even though he wins, they will rake it out. You understand me? So that is not in our constitution, not in our constitution. Even though they say the constitution, are they going to obey it? Sure, I'm very, very angry. This country, I don't even know what this country is falling into. See some people, they cannot even get this blaming in a day.
All right, Franklin from Kaduna, he's going to be our last caller. The man is filled with so much pain. But, gentlemen, let's quickly take our last line on the program and, get these issues rounded up. Yeah. Where do we go from here, Wale?
Nigerians should stop agonizing, just like Franklin.
That's what he said. He said we should stop lamenting. But you said we must lament because, the indices for that joyous
The solution now is that, yes, we must lament. I just told us that, we must lament because we do not have a father figure. And the only way we can get out of this is through laws. It's only through laws. Good laws that can make us, and good laws can only come from good legislatures. And the way we have it as the National Assembly is constituted, I don't see them making any law against corruption. It can't work. They can't, because the fear of God is lacking from the majority of those, as I see there. And the only way we can get it right is through you, the voter.
Okay.
And that's the only way. Vote in people who are God-fearing.
All right.
That's all.
And Magnesia.
Let me take it by bigger parallel. When Ahab when Elijah summoned the prophet of Baal on Mount Carmel, after slaughtering them, after they had competition about whose God answered by fire, and Jezebel started pursuing Elijah, and Elijah ran away from Jezebel. And when God asked him, Elijah, what are you doing here? He said, in the whole of Israel, there's no other prophet that has not bowed for Baal except myself. And God said no to that. That in this land, there are 7,000 people that have not bowed down for idols. And I feel like one of our callers really said, Nigerian is suffused, is surfeited with people who can lead Nigeria right. The problem is, how do they get there? At the last presidential debate, I was in Abuja to watch the debate. The woman professor who contested presidency, when he wanted to discuss, when he wanted to open his discussion, she said, perhaps there are international people here who probably don't speak. Well, French. And so she started with French. So what I'm saying is that all of us here, the listeners are listening to us. And as far as we, insofar as we try to, discharge our responsibility, civil responsibility to the society, in making sure that we get a better society, these are little contributions we are doing towards nation building. And, sometimes I think that Nigeria will get there.
Okay, Nigeria will get there. Very optimistic submissions and postulations there. Nigeria, we need a new nation. A new nation, not with the unending constitution amendment or what some people have tagged the unending jamboree. That has been our topic today on Core Digest, which reached to you from Core TV News in Lagos. I want to specially thank my guests, two gentlemen, the lawyers. First on my immediate left is Wanle Ogunade. He's a legal practitioner, and I said the other one, a lawyer, and the rest. And he's a farmer, too. You know, I must add that. My journalist friend, brother, colleague, and he's left me now. He's now a learned fellow. I don't know who is more learned, whether the journalist or the lawyer. You know, Makneza Fasehun. Thanks very much, Makneza, for being part of this program again.
It's my pleasure.
And to you all, callers and viewers, whether in Nigeria and abroad, thanks for watching our program, and we'll be coming your way again tomorrow, same time, for another interesting edition. My name is Christian Ogodo. Thanks for watching, and bye-bye.
Is it what Chrissy? What type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, checking looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face. Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to disrepute. I said, oh, help me.
On Core Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.